Welcome to the last session. Tea time is over. Now let's look at, we have looked at work interaction, so it's time for us to look at some exercises. So the last session will be devoted to some discussion of problem solving in thermodynamics. And we will take some exercises from the set of exercises, particularly that on work interaction, actually only on work interaction. Now, why have I given an hour and a half for this session? This is our first, without saying so, the first of the exercises plus interaction session. But I think it's important to consider the discipline of problem solving in thermodynamics. I don't know the scheme of evaluation or the type of papers which you have, but I feel that a quiz or an examination in thermodynamics should essentially be based on solutions of problems, or solutions of exercises. Because in thermodynamics, there is hardly any formulae to derive. There are no theorems to prove. There are only three laws, a few relations. So it's everything is about understanding and being able to solve problems. And problem solution requires many skills, from a real life situation to a reasonable idealization with appropriate assumptions, then setting up the thermodynamic systems model, and then applying our laws of thermodynamics to it and calculating things out. So while solving the problem, we should not just be able to just be concentrating on what the answer is. Quite often, for many problems in or many of these exercises, in principle you can write a formula. If you have a good enough calculator, you can simply, you know, enter the numbers in the calculator itself, get an answer and write it. It won't even take you know, one third or one fourth of a notebook page, a typical A4 size page. So by the time this particular part is over, your solution is done. We are more interested in the way a solution is obtained, a way an answer is reached, rather than the answer by itself. And I would like all of you to follow this discipline, and I would like all of you to try to inculcate this discipline in your students. I know it may be difficult because many of you are affiliated to some universities and you have absolutely no control over the type of papers and which are set, and the type of questions and the format of questions which are answered. But now that I have a large set of the thermodynamic teachers in front of me, I hope that many of you, as you grow and as you absorb this, I hope that many of you think that this is the right way to solve problems in thermodynamics. And naturally, a few of you will grow into positions that matter, like memberships of board of studies or chairmanship of board of studies. So try to then slowly change the scheme of teaching and scheme of evaluation in an appropriate way. So when it comes to problem solving in thermodynamics, remember the following. The procedure is more important than the final answer. We expect that one must be able to demonstrate understanding of the subject matter while solving a problem. And hence, to begin with, I recommend that note even your thinking as you proceed. Leave nothing to imagination, leave nothing by default. Now, let us say something, some required structure. For example, I would say typical process of solution would something like this. First, read the problem appreciate note what is specified also what is missing. Perhaps what is missing is sometimes more important than what is specified. System diagrams, diagram or diagrams. And process diagram or diagrams are always necessary. There are only a few exercises in this where you don't need a system diagram or you don't need a process diagram. Property relations, for example, that is one such subset of exercises. Otherwise, each exercise will require at least one system diagram and will require at least one process diagram. Okay. Then remember that the specification will not be complete. If a complete specification is given, there is nothing to solve except substitute. Okay. So, the specification will not be complete and hence need to make assumptions. Okay. For this, we have to look for hints which may be embedded there. Okay. So, how to look for things not specified, things missing, look for hints by appropriate words. In fact, we are teachers, so we not only solve problems, but we also have to create new problems or modify existing problems for new exercise sets or new examinations and new tests. So, remember that for setting up the question, we have a large amount of time provided to us. But for solving that question, the student only has a few minutes or maybe 1 hour or so of that kind. So we have to be faithful to the students. We should not unload it, load the student unnecessarily. So that is why we have to provide hints. And as problem solvers, we have to look for those hints. If you don't provide any hints, the student load goes up. But that's not the issue. We don't want to load the student. We don't want to make him rush against time. Then he will make silly mistakes, and we will be evaluating his ability to work under pressure and not his ability to understand basic thermodynamics. Okay. Then after making appropriate assumptions, actually these assumptions you will have to make as you progress. In fact, this is not the order in which things go, except, you know, reading the problem, appreciating and note what is specified. That will have to be there at the first, but what is missing may be realized as you proceed. A system diagram and a process diagram, you may not be able to complete at the beginning. Part of the process is something to be computed out. So as you proceed, you complete or maybe even modify that system diagram or modify that process diagram. Again, assumptions, as you proceed, you make the assumptions. It's not that, you know, the standard geometry stuff, you make the assumptions, you write all the given things in the beginning and then you simply have a once through process. In thermodynamics and in real life engineering, things are hardly ever like that. Now, after all this, we come to computation or calculation. Here we have numbers. We have numbers plus we have signs plus we have a precision involved and plus we have units involved. And we have to respect, and of course, we also have context. Work done by, work done on, that's a qualitative part. Okay. And we have to treat each one of these with appropriate respect. Any missing stuff means the answer is incomplete and quite often incorrect. Okay. Because incomplete answer is no answer. That doesn't lead to the final solution. So treat all these things with respect. And when it comes to units, and remember, units come out of the dimension, which is more abstract. Dimension is algebraic, like length into mass divided by time, or mass into length square divided by time square, and something like that. Units are arbitrary. Units, I can define my own unit, you can define your own unit. There are certain standardized sets of units, but there are a large number of technical units and conventional units which are used. For example, length can be measured in anywhere from nanometers to angstrom units to millimeters to meters, feet, yards, furlongs, miles, kilometers, light years, what parsec, and all that, what have you, right, from micro to macro. So you need to use what are known as conversion factors. And this happens to be a weak point with many of us. So we will spend some time on conversion factors. Okay. Let me take one illustration, and for that illustration, I would select one of the exercises from our exercise sheet. With whatever we have done so far, we will be able to tackle any of the exercises in the work interaction. we have WI1 to WI8, 8 work interaction exercises, plus there are additional exercises from the textbooks which are recommended. Although our standard set of units is the one which comes out of the SI system, we will be using some pseudo SI units. For example, pressure would generally be in bar, but just to provide some grinding to the students and expose him or her to the appropriate conversion factors, in this particular section on the work interaction, we have tried to create some exercises with some odd units. Okay. Let me discuss this before coming zeroing in on a particular exercise. WI1 is essentially a integration exercise. A system diagram is not really necessary. You can show a cylinder piston arrangement with a fluid in it. But a process diagram is absolutely necessary, because unless you draw a process diagram, you are not sure what you are going to integrate. The second exercise is on electric work. Third exercise is on expansion and stirring. Fourth exercise is a typical one where you have to determine the force, determine the displacement. Fifth exercise is for the compression of a solid. Sixth and seven are on elastic substances, and eight is on surface tension work, extraction and contraption of a surface area. I would like you to attempt sooner or later all of these, but just now let me take one of my favorites, and that is the exercise WI3, just to show the process. Now, I will not be writing much, so listen very carefully to what I am saying, because if I start writing, I will be writing maybe till 5 o'clock explaining all the thought processes. So let us take WI3. Let us read it and think aloud. Don't leave any thought unsaid. You know, this type of recitation is something which we were asked to do in primary school. After that, for some reason, that discipline was suppressed. I think we have to rekindle it in ourselves. Okay. So, I am reading the problem. A system containing 5 kg of some substance. It's stirred. Oh, stirred means it is something like a fluid. Maybe condensed milk or something like that. With a torque of something, the value of the torque is given, the speed at which it is turned is given, and the time for which it is turned is given. Oh, the system meanwhile expands. So, oh, it is not as thick as condensed milk, it is some fluid which is expanded. Okay, so something which can be stirred and something which expands, some funny thing. Okay. From 1 meter cube to 2 meter cube. So, initial and final volumes are given against a constant pressure which is specified. Oh, the pressure is constant, so integration seems to be easy. Determine the net work done in the unit specified. Okay, so what I have some system, closed one of course, because we have not yet discussed open systems at all. And there is a stirring involved, that is the first specification, and there is a expansion involved, and we have to determine the net work which was done. So naturally, there are two modes which are involved. Stirring plus expansion. So I can write W, need not write net, W means the total work done. This will be W stirring plus W expansion. Then what is the specification for stirring? That is given. What is the specification for expansion? That also is given. So let me be clear by sketching the system diagram. It's an expansion, so I must show a cylinder piston, and this is my system. Five kg of something, I am not sure what that is going to be used for. So we have a torque, so we have a stirrer, and we have expansion. So we have a W stirrer and we have a W expansion. Now the specification. It is stirred with a torque of 0.3 kgf meter, speed of 1000 rpm for 24 hours. So one process diagram would be something like this. This is time. So out here, I'll see after this thing is over whether there is something intermediate available. I have the torque and I have omega, and the torque is steady, and what is the value given? 0.3 kilogram force meter, 0.3 kgf meter. And what is the value of omega? Omega is given to be 1000 rpm. Although they have not mentioned it, a minor assumption here is that this is a uniform torque of 0.3 kg f per meter for a constant torque and a constant speed. And naturally, if this is 0, the total process is over in 24 hours. So this is the specification for determining W stirrer. Now let's look at the other part. The system meanwhile expands from 1 meter cube to 2 meter cube against a constant pressure of 4 kilogram force per centimeter square. So let's sketch that. This is our standard PV diagram. 1 meter cube to 2 meter cube. So the initial volume is 2 meter cube. Pressure is 4 kilogram force per centimeter square. So the initial state will be this, final state will be this, 1 and 2. Constant pressure. So the default, the assumptions are tau omega constant as given, pressure is constant. Hence, we assume process is quasi-static. Okay. Now with this, our visual depiction is ready. The system, one part of the process. Now remember, this is a process diagram which is some parameters against time. So So in this diagram, the initial state and the final state, this tau and omega are not properties of the system. Similarly, 0 to 24 hours, this time duration has nothing to do with the system as such. So there is no question of showing the initial state and final state on this diagram. But the second part of the diagram, where we have something to do with expansion work, we are given the pressure volume relationship, we are given the initial state and the final state, and then this diagram is a process diagram on the state space, or at least the PV projection of the state space. So we can show the initial state 1, we can show the final state 2, and we can show the process. Okay? All that we are given is that P is constant. And at least for integration of the expansion work as PdV, to that extent the process can be assumed quasi-static. Since no other interactions are involved, we are not relating to the state to anything else, we do not have to really worry whether the temperature and other properties are uniquely defined. We are simply looking at work interaction, and hence for the purpose of evaluating work interaction, this quasi-static assumption, a minor assumption, is good enough. And now the next thing we do is, because we know that there are two components of work, we now expand those two components. We write W stirrer is going to be minus integral from 0 to 24 hours of tau omega dt, which is going to be simply minus tau omega t, where this t is nothing but representation of 24 hours. Okay? And similarly, our W expansion, did I write Ex or Exp? Exp. So W expansion is going to be integral 1 to 2 PdV, which is going to be P integral 1 to 2 dV, which is equal to P into V2 minus V1, and this is since P is constant. And here also, from here to here, this is since tau omega are constant. Now we come to the with this, the formulation is essentially over, or actually over, because we know here tau is specified, omega is specified, t is specified, so WST can be computed. And in the second component, we know V1, we know V2, we know P, hence W expansion is computed. And hence, going back to the original formula, from this, we can now determine the net work done. Okay. In kilojoule, it is something which we have to finally take care of. Now we come to computations, and this is where we have to worry about dimensions, units, and conversion factors. Okay. My recommendation to everyone, students, faculty, is write in the formula the units also as algebra. For example, when you say multiply 3 into 4, we write 3 into 4 is 12. But now consider units as part of this. So let us say A is the unit for 3, B is the unit for 4. So we should write now 3A into 4B as 12AB, where AB is the appropriate combination of units. We may have to leave it as AB, or if AB has been defined at some another unit, say G, replace it by G. We will do that. Okay. Let us look at the first part. The first part said W stirrer is equal to minus tau omega t. Let us substitute numbers. Tau is given to us as 0.3 kilogram force meter. So write this as 0.3. I tend to use square brackets just to keep this separate. Kgf meter multiplied by 1000 rpm. So 1000 revolution per minute. multiplied by 24 hour. Now notice the numerical part can be done, 0.3 into 1000 into 24. But what about the units part? Consider the units as algebraic entities. Finally, we want the work in terms of joule or kilojoule. Okay. But here we do not seem to see anything there. We have joule we know is Newton meter, meter is there, but we do not have Newton. We have kilogram force, then we have revolution, we have minute, and we have hour. So we use conversion factor. Now what is a conversion factor? We generally remember conversion factor as x of something is equal to y of something else. For example, we remember the conversion factor that 1 inch is 2.54 centimeters or 1 meter is 100 centimeters, okay, or 1 minute is 60 seconds. Now this does not give us the real value of a conversion factor. I propose that the actual value of any conversion factor is 1. So we rewrite our conversion factors. Let us look at it on the next page and then I will come back. Conversion factor, the value is 1 and the units are something funny, but the dimension is nothing. Okay. For example, when we say, for example, we have kilogram force here. We know 1 kilogram force is 9.81 newtons. So the old style way of writing is 1 kilogram force is 9.81 newtons. But instead of that, I would like to convert it in a conversion factor, which is 9.81 newton per kilogram force. Its reciprocal is also a conversion factor, 1 over 9.81 kilogram force per newton. What is the value of this? The value of this is 1. And since it the value of any of these conversion factors, for example, other conversion factors could be 100 centimeter per meter, okay, then 60 minutes per hour, similarly 60 seconds per minute, and any such. So here let us use a few of this. Another thing which we will be using is pi radians per revolution, and actually radians actually does not have any unit, so you can say pi per revolution is itself a conversion factor. So going back, let us start doing proceeding further. Let us say 0.3, or we need not even do this, because all that we are going to do is multiply this by an appropriate number of ones. Okay. So we are not changing any value anywhere. A number or any quantity multiplied by 1 is that same quantity. Okay. But for these ones, we will now use the appropriate conversion factor. Okay. Because the value of each conversion factor is 1. So for kilogram force, to convert it into Newton, we will replace one of these by 9.81 Newton per kilogram force. Okay. Now once you do that, you can algebraically cancel kilogram force. Oh, now you have Newton meter, which is joule. So we are on the right track. But out here we have revolution which we have to get rid of, and this hour and minute which we have to get rid of. So okay, we multiply further by 1, but replace say one of the ones here by converting revolution to radians. So we have, I think I made a mistake, this should be 2 pi, am I right? 2 pi per revolution. So this is 2 pi, radians is nothing but name for a unit. So now we have got rid of revolution, and then this minute per hour. So another one, another conversion factor, which is 60 minute per hour. And when you do that, minute cancels, hour cancels. And now we know the only units remaining are Newton meter, which is joule. If you want it to be converted to kilojoules, well, you can be a purist and say multiplied by 10 raised to minus 3 kilojoule per joule. Instead of joule, we can write Newton meter. So now Newton gets cancelled with this Newton, meter gets cancelled with this meter, and you will end up with minus 0.3 into 1000 multiplied by 24 multiplied by 9.81 multiplied by 2 pi multiplied by 60 multiplied by 10 to the minus 3 kilojoule. Now use your calculators and write this out. But when you do that, do one more thing. Generally our habit is to look at our calculators and see whatever we see in the display window of the calculator and dump it on the paper. Okay. Again, this is a great tool for us to discipline our students. What the calculator shows in the display has nothing to do with the problem at hand. It is just a result of some multiplication, division, whatever operations. What is the real situation? You will notice here that none of the factors here which are specified, 24,000, 0.3, have more than 2 or 3 significant figures. Okay. There may be, this is very precise, but that does not add any information. So whatever you do is you calculate this out with minus a number and write it in kilojoules. I am not calculating this out, but 3 or at most 4 significant figures. I leave it to yourself to put the appropriate number here. Okay. Note, I am not saying decimal figures, but significant figures. Okay. Now you may laugh at it. Why do we have to do this long-winded thing? We may not have to do, but we should force our students, at least in the initial part of their study of thermodynamics, and for that matter any subject, by using this long-winded methods, because that way they will appreciate how to do calculations, and they will appreciate how to treat numbers with respect, and they will appreciate what exactly is meant by conversion factor, why we use them, and how to use conversion factors properly. Now, this happens with W stirrer, and you can get the actual value. The next thing is W expansion. Do it in a similar fashion. W expansion we have determined is P V2 minus V1, and P is given to us as 4 kilogram force per centimeter square, so 4 kgf per centimeter square multiplied by V2 minus V1, 2 minus 1. Actually, if you are a purist, you should write here 2 meter cube minus 1 meter cube, but since meter cube is common, I will take it common. Otherwise, suppose I were to tell you that it goes from 1200 liters initial volume to 2 meter cube as the final volume. In which case you will have to write 2 meter cube here minus 1200 liters, and now of course you can't subtract liters from meter cube, so you will have to first convert that liters into meter cube by using a conversion factor which is 1 by 1000 meter cube per liter, and then everything comes in meter cube, which you can take out as common. Now here you will see that finally we want in joule or kilojoule, but we don't seem even to have meter. We have a meter cube and a centimeter square, and we have a kilogram force. So although the dimensions match, the units don't match. So naturally we will use appropriate number of conversion factors and replace each one of these by the suitable conversion factor. First we will need kilogram force to Newton. So 9.81 Newton per kilogram force. Something to convert centimeter square to meter square. So you write 10 raised to 4 centimeter square per meter square. Now this way kilogram force cancels out, centimeter square cancels out, meter square cancels with meter square here, only meter remains. So now we have Newton meter. Since we want kilojoules, you can even write 10 raised to minus 3 kilojoule per Newton meter. And now Newton cancels with this Newton, this meter cancels with this meter, and you have the answer as 4 into 2 minus 1 is 1 into 9.81 into 10 raised to 4 into 10 raised to minus 3 kilojoule. Again, write this and be conscious of this as plus something kilojoule. Again, remember 3 to 4 significant figures, because that is what our specification is. And finally, again, W is going to be W stirrer plus W expansion. So you calculate out the value and write the units kilojoules. Okay. Again, while doing this, it's possible that you end up with a large number and a small number, in which case take care of the significant figures and you have to write the appropriate number here. Now with this, I hope I have impressed on you the detailed procedure of solving the problem. And now I will do the following. We have about 45 minutes. So I recommend that you attempt the following problems. I expect different centers to take up different problems first, and I am available here for any interaction. I will visit a few centers as you solve the problems. Although all 8 exercises and the additional exercises are recommended, what you attempt just now are WI4, WI5, and then WI8. You can do something like this. Divide your center number by 3. If the remainder is 0, attempt with 4 first. If the remainder is 1, attempt with 5 first. The remainder is 2, attempt WI8 first. And of course, later on you go to the other exercises. One, two, three, two, Jayalakshmi Institute at Thoppur, Tamil Nadu. Over to you.
So, in conversion factor for converting joules into kilojoules, you wrote there kilojoules per Newton meter. The 1 Newton meter is equal to joules, is it right? Then always writing kilojoules per Newton meter instead of kilojoules per joules. Is there any difference between kilojoules per joules and kilojoules per Newton meter? What is it?
Okay, good question. I think I am happy that you have started looking at nitty gritty. In fact, when I write something kilojoule per Newton meter, actually those are 2 conversion factors combined into 1. If you are a real purist, I should write 10 raised to minus 3 kilojoule per joule multiplied by 1 joule per Newton meter, because 1 joule per Newton meter is not a conversion factor, that is the definition of joule. whereas 10 raised to minus 3 kilojoule per joule would be the definition of the prefix kilo. So what you are saying is right, in principle we could do that, but we need not insist that we go to that extent. If you get the idea of how to use conversion factors, then you have won the case. Thank you.
Sir, our sun family, the sun is going to die because of no fuel. Could our engineering thermodynamics help for this making our sun alive?
You are asking a question which is, I think, beyond the scope of this course. Yeah, I think you are saying something about the death of the sun, right?
Sir, our earth problem is one of the major issues of earth, sir, because sun is going to be die because without fuel.
Yeah, what I suggest is you go to perhaps an old library and look up a book by George Gamow. It is called The Birth and Death of the Sun. You will get enough information there, and then you should actually discuss this with somebody like Professor Narlikar, who is an astronomer, cosmologist, okay, rather than in a course on thermodynamics. Thank you. 1219 Prestige Institute, Indore. Over to you, sir.
I am Srikant Tare from Indore, Prestige Institute of Engineering and Engineering Science. I am trying to solve this WF4.
Yes.
And the pressure is rather the area normal to this pressure. It is x into b.
The width of the channel is b normal to the plane of the paper on which this figure is printed.
Yeah, so P0 is the pressure exerting on the area, that is x and b.
Pressure P0 is pressure exerted on the area which is x by b, you are right.
Yeah, so when I am seeing that F equal to, it has to be proved that P0 h into b.
Force will be P0 into x into b. X into b, the force because of air on the water.
Yeah, the force, yeah, so the force exerted on the piston, what it is written is H into B.
Yes, that formula is right. This is the force exerted by water on the piston. This is right. You have to derive it properly using some principles of hydrostatics.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Over and out. 1194 Gandhi Engineering College, Orissa. Over to you.
Sir, we have used the expression to calculate the force pressure into area, that is the pressure exerted, atmospheric pressure, P0. Area will be base into height, WI.4.
Yes, the part A I suppose you are working on, right? Yes. What is the question? What is the problem there?
Actually, the question is that the force exerted by the water on the piston is F is equal to P0 plus rho gh divided by 2 base into height.
Yes, that expression is right.
So there we are using equations, that is the force exerted on the piston will be exerted by the water will be equal to the force exerted first, because the water has to do work against the atmospheric pressure plus the pressure that is exerted by the piston.
See, for determining the force, the idea of work does not come into operation. This is simple hydrostatic. First thing you do is you take the point in the water which is at the height h and touching the piston. The atmospheric pressure which acts downwards is P0. Because of Pascal's law, pressure is the same in any direction. So the pressure acting on the piston because of the water at the upper level of water is also P0 horizontally. Okay. Now go down the piston, start diving in the water. Because of hydrostatic, as you go down, the pressure increases. At the top, the pressure is P0. At the bottom, the pressure is P naught plus rho g h. Since there is a linear increase, the mean pressure will be the average of the pressure at the top, which is P naught, and the pressure at the bottom, which will be P naught plus rho g h. So, when you take P naught plus rho g h, whole thing divided by 2, you get the expression in the big brackets, the first factor. This mean pressure, when multiplied by the area on which it acts, which is h into b, gives you the force acting on the piston because of water. Over. Is that clear?
Wee bit. Calculate the work done. Calculate the work done by the water on the piston.
Yes. Yes.
And by the atmosphere on the water.
Right. Now, remember that what you have obtained is the force acting on the piston, or the force exerted by water on the piston. Now, piston is moving out from x1 to x2. Okay. Now, what is going, it is a channel of constant width. So, the process equation is going to be the volume of water is going to remain unchanged. So, the height when the piston is at a location h is going to be given by the relation h into x into b, which is the volume of water at any x, equal to the initial volume, which will be h1 into x1 into b. So, this gives you a relation between h and x, just the way we have for a gas a relation between p and v. So, you can say this is sort of an equation of state for water in that channel. Okay. Use this equation and the force equation and integrate it out and you get the result.
So, the answer is, can you verify the answer, sir, please? 1 by 4 rho g h.
I do not have the answer here just now. Today late evening I will upload the solution of this. Okay. So, you can check it out. I will upload the solution of all WIs sometime late today evening. So, over and out. 1182 NK Orchid College, Solapur, over to you.
Sir, I have a doubt regarding work interaction. So, where does the flow work stands? Is it a non-quasi-static process? If yes, then how to find out the flow work?
First thing is, we have not yet come to flow work. Flow work will is something which is associated with open thermodynamic systems. Just now we are solving exercises from the work interaction part and no flow work is involved, because no flow is involved anywhere here. Over to you.
WI2, sir. So, in that exercise number WI2.
WI2, okay.
So, in that the answer which I got power is 1150 watt and number of units of electricity 2.30 units. In that my doubt is that if suppose the environmental whatever the power is generated in the form of heat due to the passage of the current, that power, if it is given to the atmosphere, if it is convected to the atmosphere, then only the power consumption will be uniform. If the power is not convected to the atmosphere, in that case the resistance will go on changing and in that case the power consumption will be different. So, regarding that, you please clarify.
Yeah, I think your real life situation is okay. All that you have to make is a assumption that the resistance of 50 ohms remains unchanged during the period of 2 hours. Okay. Unless you make that assumption, you cannot really proceed, because what happens to the resistance will depend on how the resistor or the heater behaves. If the heater, energy provided to the heater is removed by some means, say by cooling, etc., then it may remain unchanged. If not, it will change. If it changes, then we will have to specify the way it changes. over and out, 1222 Chameli Devi Group of Institutions, Indore. Over to you.
I am N.K. Jain and asking one question, that in most of the mechanical engineering books, T is used for torque and N for RPM, but you are introducing other symbols. We may be slightly confused.
See, there is nothing special about symbols. If you are comfortable with some other symbols, just edit the notes and edit the files with any other symbols you are comfortable with. There are hardly any set of symbols which is standardized, so I won't insist that you use my symbols. If you are more comfortable with some other symbols, go ahead and use them. There is nothing wrong in that. 1040 COEP, now I can hear you, I suppose.
As per your problem solving procedure, we are solving the problems. But do you have the answers of this?
Yeah, today evening I will upload the solution procedures on the Moodle. So you will be able to see them. They will be on the coordinators Moodle. So you ask the coordinators to download them and give them to you.
Okay, sir. And one more theoretical simple problem, sir. The work instruction and the force into displacement. In that derivation, dW is equal to minus T dx. So why this minus sign?
Because if you see, you are talking of that T dx, right? For the extensible string. Am I right?
Minus tau dx, huh?
Minus T dx or minus tau dx, right? Let me go back and see what symbols I used. Yeah, minus T dx. Yes, that minus T dx is because if you see, when I hold the tension strut, the tension is in the minus x direction, whereas I am trying to extend it in the plus x direction. Unlike in case of a pressure, the pressure is in the same direction in which the piston moves for expansion. So it is P dV, whereas in case of this thing, it is minus T dx because the tension is pulling our hand in. A taut string, if you leave, will run away from you, whereas a piston which held against pressure, if you leave, the piston will move towards you.
One more question, sir.
Yes.
Sir, while explaining extensive intensive property, that time understood. But after few minutes, there is very difficult to understand what is extensive and intensive property. Very simple, but very difficult to remember.
See, it is the extensive, the main confusion that happens about extensive or intensive is the following. One should understand that a property, there is a students think that a property is either extensive or intensive. That's not true. There are properties which are neither extensive or intensive. Although most of the properties which we come across will either be extensive or intensive. Okay. For example, there are generally we come across in thermodynamics only two properties which are inherently intensive. Those are pressure and temperature. You know, all other properties like energy, enthalpy, entropy, volume, mass, these are by their very nature extensive properties. Okay? But when we define them as or redefine the specific properties, for example, volume per unit mass, entropy per unit mass, that is specific volume, specific entropy, or the reciprocal of specific volume, which is density, mass per unit volume. These turn out to be ratios of two extensive properties, and hence they turn out to be intensive properties. Okay? But you can, for example, mass is a property. Okay? But square of mass can also be a property, nothing wrong in it, it is not much useful. but the square of mass will neither be an intensive property nor an extensive property. That you can check out, but this is a pathological illustration. But we have to define the properties at extensive and intensive because everybody has been talking about it. Otherwise, there is nothing very special about them. But tell the student that there are properties which you can't classify as extensive or intensive. An area is a typical example. You take a loaf of bread. The loaf of bread has an area which is L by B, all those things, 2 into LB plus BH plus LH, whatever. Okay. Now, partitioning means convert it into slices. Now, what is the total area of the partitioned system? It is much larger than that of the loaf of the bread. This is the simplest example I give quite often to those who get confused. I hope that satisfies you. Over.
Yes.
Over and out. 1223 RBS Engineering, Bichpuri, Uttar Pradesh. Over to you.
Good evening, sir. Sir, I want to ask, is internal energy a property of system or not? If it is a property of system, is it an intensive property or extensive property?
We have not yet defined internal energy. That we will do tomorrow when we come to first law. But to satisfy your question, an internal energy is the property of a system. The internal energy is an extensive property of the system, but the specific internal energy, that is internal energy per unit mass, happens to be an intensive property of the system. Over and out, or is there another question?
Over and out.
Thank you. 1047 SDM College of Engineering and Technology, Dharwad. Over to you.
Sir, my doubt is with WI5. Sir, this is a problem related with solid mechanics, saying that a block which is subjected to hydrostatic pressure, sir. And this that is bulk modulus is given, and it has been bulk modulus is defined as hydrostatic pressure divided by change in volume. And how to relate this change in volume with this work done on the, that is, block, sir?
Okay. You will get the details when I upload the solution today evening. I will just tell you that this is an extreme case of a fluid. Now, a fluid we consider very compressible, so that whenever there is a change in pressure, there is a reasonably significant change in volume. Whereas for a incompressible liquid or a solid like this, although we consider solids to be more or less incompressible, they are not absolutely incompressible. And now you will see that the bulk modulus is has a very large value here. Okay. Isothermal bulk modulus is 2 into 10 raised to 12 dyne per centimeter square. Now, this means that a large amount of pressure is required to create a small change in volume. But the formula here is still integral P dV. The only difference is that the dV will get related to dP using the bulk modulus relation. You write the bulk modulus relation B, which is defined as minus partial of P with respect to V at constant T, expand it as minus V dP divided by dV, where dP is a small change in pressure, dV is a small change in volume, both at constant temperature. And then whenever you come to PdV, replace dV, you will get to replace dV by something like minus into V into dP divided by B. And you will finally get an integral in terms of dP rather than in terms of dV. Although it looks like a solid mechanics problem, but it's actually an absolutely basic thermodynamics problem. Don't just think that because you get terms like bulk modulus and things like that, it's immediately moved to solid mechanics. It's as much thermodynamics as anything else. And of course, thermodynamics doesn't say that this problem is unique to thermodynamics. thermodynamics works very well with other branches of physics. So, if solid mechanics people want to look at it, they are welcome. We have no fight with them. Over to you. Any other question?
Hello sir, myself Manjunath sir. Sir, my problem is with WI4 sir.
Right, go ahead.
Here you have taken hydrostatic pressure rho gh WI4 sir.
Yes.
So, in this you have taken hydrostatic pressure rho gh divided by 2 as the mean pressure sir on both sides of the piston and the wall sir. Why can't you not taken this atmosphere pressure P0 sir?
No, I have taken both. As I think I have explained this to some other center earlier, I do not know whether you heard it at that time or not. See, if you look at the water level, the top of the water, the pressure by atmosphere on water is P0, right? So, at that point, because of Pascal's law, the pressure imposed by water on the piston at the level of water is also P0 by Pascal's law, pressure is the same in all directions. Then you go to hydrostatics, as you go down the pressure increases linearly and at the bottom the pressure will be P0 plus rho gh. So, at the top the pressure is P0, at the bottom the pressure is P0 plus rho gh. So, the average pressure because of the linear pressure profile is P0 plus P0 plus rho gh whole divided by 2, which turns out to be P0 plus rho gh by 2. 1263 Techno India, Salt Lake, Kolkata, over to you.
Actually, my question is regarding property again. That is, if it is true that property can be only defined if the system is in thermal or the thermodynamic equilibrium.
Yes, a property value can be uniquely defined only if it is in thermodynamic equilibrium. In fact, the definition is the other way. If we have the values of all properties uniquely defined, then the state is said to be in thermodynamic equilibrium.
Then only property can be defined. Otherwise, you cannot specify a state with the help of property. If it is not in thermodynamic equilibrium.
No, you can't, because unique values of properties are not available.
Right. Okay, sir, I have one more question. When you have defined the property, you have underlined the word relevant characteristics to specify a particular state, right? Actually, this relevant term is related to a process, but state is an instantaneous thing, na? At a particular position. Then why relevant term you are adding in the definition of property?
No.
Over to you, sir.
The relevant is not related to property. Relevant is related to characteristic. See, when we see for example, we solve problems regarding cylinder piston, right? Now, a gas in a cylinder will have a certain volume, but the volume is defined by a certain length and certain diameter. We solve lots of problems looking at only the volume without really looking at the length and the diameter. We say length and diameter will take care of themselves. So far as the problem is concerned at that instant or the solution procedure, we decide that although length is a property of the system, we can define it at any instant. Diameter also is a property of the system, we can define it at any instant. Length and diameter under that circumstance for that problem solution are not relevant characteristic, whereas volume is.
If that particular characteristic is changing, then also the state will change. So, in that case that will be relevant. So, when you are defining a property, then why relevant term should be used?
Because if I do not use the term relevant, for every system you will end up with a list of 1000 properties or a few dozen properties at least.
This is true, na?
Yes, but do you really consider all
property?
Yes, but it all depends on to what detail and to what extent you want to analyze the situation. For example, that is what I was going to tell you, that although we solve cylinder piston arrangement without really worrying about length and diameter, but suppose you want to design or analyze the combustion process in an IC engine, then only volume will not do. Then you will have to worry about the length and the diameter also. So that is a situation where you will have to consider length and diameter as properties along with the volume.
I understood your point, but my objection is that in the definition of property, this term should be avoided actually, because it is a general definition, not for a particular process.
I think you are getting confused. I am not using the word relevant for property. I am using the word relevant for a general characteristic. There are a large number of characteristics, only the relevant ones you consider as properties. Properties are always relevant. Whereas characteristic may be relevant or irrelevant, and that too under a particular situation. What is an irrelevant characteristic today may become a relevant characteristic tomorrow.
Thank you very much.
The last interaction today is with 1207 Jawaharlal Institute, Borawan.
Sir, I would like to ask regarding question WI5.
Go ahead.
As you have explained, the pressure and volume, we have analyzed that this could be 1 to 2 P dV. So, we feel that the pressure is also changing as well as the volume. So, right. are we going to integrate both these?
Okay, see, there are some crucial words here. Read the statement, assume that the density and isothermal bulk modulus of the metal remain in bracket almost constant. Okay, now that means that as the process goes, if you draw the PV diagram, the process goes increase in pressure, but the change in volume is very small. So, as the pressure changes, you can assume the volume to remain essentially constant. You can take it out of the integration and write it in terms of density and mass. Mass anyway is fixed. The density remains almost constant. That means the volume remains almost constant. So, finally, the integral will turn out to be only in terms of PdP. Integral of P dP will be the integrand, everything else will come out of the integral sign. Over to you. And over and out, and to all of you, we have had a nice but short set of interactions today. From tomorrow afternoon, we will have almost 3 hours for interaction and problem solving, so we will have more fun. Thank you, and that's all for today.